Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for tuning in. I'm Henrik Palmgren. Redeyes.tv is the website. I hope you've been enjoying the victory of one of the most unlikely presidential candidacies in American history, at least if we are to ask and believe the mainstream media. But as usual, they are out of touch, and they were trying to manifest a Hillary into office by attacking Trump. But as we know, none can challenge the superior power of kick. Praise kick. The alt-right trolled Donald J. Trump all the way to the White House, and we should be very, very proud. Now let's see if he can deliver and how much he will be blocked along the way, but this is going to be very, very interesting to see. And by the way, do watch our election night coverage if you haven't already. It was an exciting night. We had tons of people dropping by. Also, of course, subscribe to our YouTube channel. It's youtube.com/redeyesradio. Enable alerts and get notifications when we go live, as we will continue and expand in our coverage. It's been such a busy week and so much going on that we'll see if we can do a shorter weekend warrior on Sunday this time. We'll see. But the next big live thing we're doing is the MPI conference coming up Saturday, the 19th of November. We'll bring you the entire conference, live streaming of the speeches, plus interviews and a lot of other stuff. Do stay tuned to the website for the schedule and updates, redeyes.tv/live. Well, today we're going to bring you an interview that was recorded before election night, just a day or two before. We are going to speak with John Lash from Metahistory.org, a scholar in the Gnostic traditions, and one that has in many ways developed along the same path as we here on Red Eyes when it comes to our concern about the three Abrahamic religions and the role in European history, and also the, for some, controversial area of white genocide. The elite's decision to end national sovereignty and the self-determination of people in European countries around the world is an extremely important question, and John shares those sentiments. So today we're going to speak about truth seekers and knowledge holders. Lash came with a proposal when we invited him back on the show, and he wanted to discuss at this time the most important points, the most important topics that all truth seekers should insist others looking into, recognize them as tremendously important areas, and also for the aspiration that these could serve as points of agreements despite differences over other issues. So kind of an attempt of pulling many different strains into one concise direction. John Lash has been a regular guest on Red Eyes Radio since 2008, sharing the discoveries of his studies in the fields of directive and sidereal mythology, naked eye astronomy, precession, the world ages, religion, and also, of course, his radical revision of Gnosticism. He is the author of Not in His Image. He has also delved deeply into the story of what he calls Sophia's story, the Gnostic vision of the planet. And he's one who introduced the term and the concept of the archons to our discourse as well. We have an extended segment for you today, and this is an interesting lineup of topics to consider from John Lash. So stay tuned. John Lash, it is good to have you back on the show. You've been out of the interview circuit for a while, so it's great to finally have you back, my friend. Always a pleasure.
Well, it's really good to be with you at this tremendous moment on the planet. And yes, I did go off air for about a year. I had to step back and take a look at my message and what I'm delivering and how I want to deliver it.
Yeah, you know, the theme we're going to talk about today is truth keepers or knowledge holders and truth seekers to really kind of get into this question of you know, kind of where we go next, right? What are some of the unifying factors and what can we kind of agree on? But one of the things I just want to mention before we go there is a number of the positive advancements that has occurred since we spoke last time. Some victories, really, against the global powers. We, of course, had Brexit in the UK, which now it has been revealed in the last few days that the high up, you know, City of London bankers and lawyers, globalists and members of a certain tribe are trying to actually stop. They're having Parliament vote to approve the article that will trigger Britain to leave the EU, to hope that it kind of gets denied. And then, of course, we've had the interesting, very interesting ascendancy of Trump, which the whole system seems to have more or less turned against. And you reminded me of something, John, and I recall seeing this in Jurij Luna's film In the Shadow of Hermes, the fact that on November 8th, 1917, we had the Bolshevik takeover of the Winter Palace, and it occurred, interestingly enough, precisely... 17. Yeah, 1917, precisely at 2:12 a.m., precisely on the directions of an astrologer.
That's right.
And we had, you know, we have an election night coming up, and it's it's going to be the 99th anniversary of that event. So one has to wonder if this, the big prize of the US, right, the jewel of the Bolsheviks, it seems like, if they will try to do something similar on the night of November 8th. What do you think?
Well, I think that one of the, among the many positive changes we might mention, one of them is that the adversaries of life and freedom and love and play and joy and free speech and good sex, you know, are showing their hand. They're showing their hand now. And the game is running very close. And we're on to them. We're on to their game. And their system is collapsing right in front of our eyes. So it's our responsibility to do what we can at the critical moment, you know, to be poised and ready at the critical moment. This is certainly no coincidence that this is a momentous date coming up, is the 99th anniversary of the Bolshevik takeover, because the Bolsheviks are the problem. The Nazis are not the problem, folks. You need to correct and go back and learn history if you still think, you know, Nazi is an as a anti-white hate speech. That's what the word Nazi is. And the Nazis are not the problem. The problem on this planet is the Marxist communist Bolsheviks. So it's their anniversary, but it's our party.
Yeah, exactly. Good point. Yeah, and I mean, the Nazis, they're the ones who are fighting the Bolsheviks. They're the ones who lined up and sacrificed themselves.
Absolutely. You know? That's right. That's right. That's right.
So knowledge holders, we're going to talk a bit here about our premise, right, of knowledge holders that actually have a commitment to take a stance and act based on standards of knowledge and certain principles, based on facts, basically. But you sent me an opening statement that I'm going to read first to kind of set the stage a bit. And for those who don't remember, we can go through some of this later, but we've spoken with John before about, you know, what the quest for the Holy Grail really is, right? John Lash is an expert in mythology and, you know, comparative mythology and these kinds of aspects, if you haven't heard him before. And we've done some tremendous interviews together. But let me just read this opening statement. A myth is a guiding narrative produced by the imagination of the human species to direct the species towards its proper development, expressions of talents, unfoldments of innate genius, orientation to nature and the cosmos. It also provides the models and ideals for morality, ethics, education, and creative inspiration. Ultimately, the genuine myth shows us, as individual and species, how to be self-directing. Self-directing is an aspect of sovereignty. Self-direction is the existential stance of the free human animal. But you can only be self-direction within the frames of a master narrative. Tell us what you mean by this.
Okay. I consider myself to be the heir and successor of Joseph Campbell in certain respects, but primarily because in his book, Native Mythology, Campbell set out a program for the power, meaning the power of myth. The power of myth, while there can be deception in myth, there can be sick myth, there can be sick myths, like the myth of the Messiah is the pathological myth. But the power in genuine is that they guide the individual and they guide the species. And so what all my work is about is teaching how to use the power of imagination. One of the positive changes that's come about now that the corrupt power system is coming down is that you see more and more people saying the same thing, maybe in different words. But you see more and more people say over the last 2 or 3 years saying, hey, we've got the power. But what is the power we've got? Well, it's the power of imagination. And what we imagine, we can bring about. And so there's a lot of encouraging talk and inspiring talk in that vein. I'm sure you know what I mean, don't you, Henrik?
Yeah.
And what I'm saying is, I have a role. This is my unique role, if you will. I'm telling you that having the power of imagination, yeah, let's go for it. But it's not enough. You also need the skill. You know, if I say here, I've got a Maserati sitting out here in my driveway. I give you the keys. This Maserati, you know, a 16 valve, it goes from 0 to 60 in 3 seconds. You've got the keys. Put them in the ignition of my Maserati. You've got the power. But do you have the skill to drive that Maserati? Do you have the skill to direct, to take the directive power of imagination and use it as a tool for change, for revolution, for correction, for healing? And this is the big question in front of us. The power, as the corrupt power structure falls as we're speaking, it's collapsing and crumbling as we speak. The news is coming in. You said you can't stop with it, can you?
No.
Every 12 hours, there's a report on the alternative media about the power structure crumbling, right? So now the power comes into our hands. The question I ask you is, what is the myth that directs you? What is the narrative that directs you? And do you have the skill to handle the power that it gives you? I'm gambling on one idea. You and I agreed, Henrik, that we were going to focus this talk on one theme. What can unite the people who have seen the truth? Not those who are still looking around, those are going down rabbit holes. Not those who are still trying to figure it out or lost in some Illuminati, fog bank. But those who hold the truth holders, what can unite them and give us a unified front? This is the topic of our conversation tonight, isn't it?
Yeah, this is an incredibly important aspect to it, because I have struggled for years in past shows. It's not a struggle. It's part of the quest, basically. But you talk about seeker's syndrome, right? That, you know, you can struggle looking for the truth as opposed to act on it. This is completely reasonable. Oftentimes, you know, the most convicted people are those who think they know everything and think they have all the truth, but they don't, and they end up acting on false information, misinformation, and flat out lies that it's designed to divert. But at some point in the process of seeking the truth, you need to begin to act on it. There needs to be an agreement, you know, to a certain extent of what you can agree on. There are, of course, uncertainties along the way. There are smaller details that can be churned out that should be discussed and researched. But if you end up living your life not taking a stand based on the truth that you know, you will never get anywhere. You'll never get anything done. And at least when it comes to, you know, resisting evil and fighting those who are trying to destroy us. And I think ambiguity in that sense is actually part of the conspiracy. This idea that we can never really know anything, or, you know, everything is always subjective. And I think this is a lie put out by, you know, those we're fighting, our enemies, the establishment, to prevent us from acting against them.
It's misdirection. It's misdirection. You know, my response would be, I'll put it in first person, because this is all personal and personal, both. Deeply personal matters we're talking about here. I'll put it in the first person. I don't claim to know, you know, all of the truth. I claim to know enough of the truth, enough of it, to be ready to act. And I think what's really important now, and I know you agree because we set up this interview on this premise, let's see if we can name, make a sort of an inventory of items, are the truth that we know that all truth holders hold in common, that we can make that our platform of unity. Because as you know, Henrik, much better than me, because you're right out there in the fray of it, and I'm kind of always in a retreat position. There's so much division and infighting and slander and ridiculous chatter among people who are supposedly fighting for the same goal, right?
Yep.
And I'm sick of this. I'm sick of this. I'm beyond it already. And so we're dedicating this talk, first part of this talk, to discussing the points in a platform. We're going to itemize them specifically that are held by truth holders, not people who are still searching, who are caught in the seeker syndrome. Oh, it's the journey, not the goal. Oh, it's the seeking process, and it doesn't matter where it leads you. Wrong. Wrong. It matters where the seeking process leads you. And So let's, shall we cover the list of 8 items and 9 items that's in our notes?
Yeah, okay. I definitely want to hear more about this, John. So please go ahead. Let's get into it.
And before I do that, I want to give you a little tool. Let me give you a little tool that I discovered very early on in my study of Buddhism. I couldn't have been more than 20, that I found very helpful. There is a distinction between conditional truth and ultimate truth. And it's a very clear distinction in Buddhist teachings. That is to say, those Buddhist teachings which are still worth your attention, not those which you can toss in the trash, okay? This is one of the paramount tools that I have acquired, and I pass it on to you in this way. I use the language, well, there is truth, which is ultimate truth, and then there is the truth. For instance, let's talk about the Kennedy assassination, or talk about 9/11, or talk about the Federal Reserve. What is the truth about the Federal Reserve System? What is the truth about 9/11? Okay? That's the conditional truth. That's what they call samvriti satya. Satya is the Sanskrit word for truth. And samvriti means it's the truth according to the impressions or the evidence. So we're going to talk tonight about the truth and the criterions for the truth. And as we do so, don't mistake that we are making some statements about ultimate truth. That's another conversation. That's another thing. So I'm not claiming that I have ultimate truth and I alone have ultimate truth, blah, blah, blah. That's a misrepresentation. But we have certain items that we know to be true now. And I think it's imperative to list what they are and hold them up as the standards for a unity and a coherent action going forward. So the notes say, is it possible, they ask this question. I'm going to publish the notes for our talk on my website, by the way. So anyone who listens to the talk can go see the actual notes we're working from. Is it possible to outline a standard or set of criteria for those who hold the truth about certain matters, so that we can have a basis for unanimity? Okay, so let's go through. This is my proposition of what those points might be. Number one, Henrik, I turn it over to you.
The JQ.
The JQ, that's right. Okay, so the way that I live is, if you can't agree with me on the truth about the Jewish question, then we cannot be in a unified front. That's all. And it's okay. Go your own way. I don't resent you or hate you for that. But this is a criterion, okay? And what is the GQ? Well, it's simply the knowledge, the certainty, which can be proven, that particular Jews who have power and influence are running things in the non-Jewish world, and they're running them into ruin and destruction. Particular Jews. I call them JIPs, J-I-P, which is the Jews of Influence and Power. So if you look all over the world, you find that these Jews of influence and power, these JIPs, have an agenda of deliberate harm with intent to dominate and destroy the goyim. This is the JQ. And they are disproportionately represented in non-Jewish affairs. They enforce the cult of righteousness. Want me to translate that in plain English?
Yeah.
They dictate to everyone else in the world how we should live, right?
That's right.
They live as they wish, but they dictate to the goyim, the non-Jewish world, how we should live. And they operate on the scapegoat oppressor mechanism. They pretend to be the greatest victim in the world, and yet they use that ploy to victimize us in the world. And remember my language, those particular Jews in power and influence who perpetrate this program. It's known who they are, Barbara Spector. I mean, all the evidence is out there, okay? The truth about the Jewish question is out there. So that's the first platform, I would say, in the platform of unanimity, to have a unified front, to have a coherent movement that can really move and take power now. We want to take power in the world using the power of imagination and using what has the, we have been able to learn since 9/11. Another point I would make about the understanding the JQ very quickly is that the Zads, as I call them, which is from the Zadokite sect, the righteous ones of the ancient Hebrews, they are the executive cabal of this deviant satanic group. Hitler called it a satanic cabal, operating against the rest of humanity. And they also use the unwitting Jews who have nothing to do with their program as a human shield. So I have, strange to say it, but I'm going to say it, you know, I'm going to say the word, the C word. I do have compassion for those Jews who identify with being Jewish and do not realize that they are the unwitting dupes of those particular Jews who are evil. But unfortunately, they are all part of the same problem. And this is a very, this is the great tragedy of being Jewish. Finally, I just point out that my view of the Jewish question always refers back to the Gnostics. You find in the Gnostic materials an explicit warning. When we did our talk on the archontic infection in August of 2014, Henrik, I quoted the Gnostic warning that said that the Jews are proxies to the archons. Okay? Those particular Jews are proxies to the archons. And so that brings the archon factor in, it brings in the supernatural, and it relates to a vast mythological scenario, which is the history of our species according to the Sophianic myth. So this is a big, big issue, the Jew question.
Yeah, indeed. Well, just one question about this, the Zadokites, the Zads, is that a, do you know if that is a self-identifying word or concept that they use, or is that just kind of an appropriate term coming to us from the mythological record that we can use to identify those that are in power and of influence?
It is a word that every truth holder needs to register in your mind and hold in your vocabulary. It is not just a label to describe something, but it is the self-designated description. It comes from the Hebrew word zadik, which means the righteous or the supreme. So hence, Jewish supremacy, Jewish racist supremacy, is actually rooted not in the entire field of ancient Jewish religion. It comes out of a splinter cult, which was called the Zadikim, or Zadokites. And if you go to metahistory.org and you put in search Zadokim, you'll find an extensive profile. Now, today, you don't find them using that word very much. They are inflicting their sense of righteousness on everybody all the fucking time. And I am so sick of it. And I know that millions of people are sick of having these righteous Jews telling me how to live, you know? But it is a fact that they have designated themselves as the righteous and the supreme. And it is something that you can investigate, as I say, by looking into the Zadokite sect. Today, the closest you hear would be the Lubavitch. Lubavitch rabbis.
Right.
They are Zads. Okay. The rabbis you see pictured with Obama at the White House, they are Zads. They are Zadokite. And it is an even, it's a splinter sect within the Talmudic sect of the Jewish religion. But the great paradox is that they're not really religious. It's a political ideology of total domination, just like Islam. So.
Yeah, that's an interesting point. You know, sometimes it's a religion, other times they claim it's a race, and they can kind of flip-flop and go between these two whenever it fits them. But just one more item on this. the sure. very issue of the chosen people, of course, very much plays into this. I mean, in a world that has been flooded with a morality that preach equality, anti-hierarchy, and these kinds of things, that in many cases coming from, you know, Jewish advocates, the concept of a chosen people is, of course, right against that morality that has been preached to us. And I think that that's kind of related to the Zadokites that you're talking about here.
Well, absolutely. I can assure you, as a comparative mythologist, that I've looked into the mythology, the folklore of literally hundreds of cultures, like American Indian cultures, the Aztecs, the Maya, the Chinese, the Polynesians, the Greeks, the Romans, the Persians, you get it. And I assure you that there is only one case in all of those cultures where the people define themselves as the chosen ones of God, mandated to lord over the rest of humanity.
Yeah.
And that notion, that sick, toxic myth, that is the sick myth, that notion comes out of the imagination, not of the Jewish people as a whole, but of the Zadokite sect of the ancient Talmudic Jews.
So on number two, we have holofacts, very interesting point.
Holofacts, right. So I'm on the same page with anybody who has seen the evidence of the Holocaust. Now, we're not even going to spend 4 minutes on this because it speaks for itself, okay, Henry? Because we could talk for 2 hours about that, right?
At least, yeah.
I'll just give you one example. Do you know, you people listening to me, know how long it takes to burn the body of an average human adult? With the best equipment available today, with state-of-the-art crematoria, how long it takes to burn the body of an adult? 2 to 2.5 hours.
Yeah.
Now, if you want to burn 10 adults at the same time, then it takes 22 hours. If you want to burn 100 at the same time, it takes 220 hours. If you work out that calculation, this is how I worked it out. I said 4.5 million of the 6 million were adults and 1.5 million were children, okay? So of the 1.5 million that were children, they burned in only an hour. And 4.5 million adults burned in 2.5 hours. Calculate the Holocaust. How long would it take to burn 6 million bodies? 1,200 years. I kid you not.
Say that again.
If you calculate the Holocaust based on the actual time that it takes to burn to ashes human bodies, it would take over 1,200 years to burn 6 million bodies. 724.
Amazing.
That is the magnitude of the lie, right? And Goebbels, bless his Germanic soul, said famously, well, the bigger the lie is, the easier it is to get people to believe it, didn't he?
Anyway. Yeah, that's right.
But what people don't know is that when Goebbels said that, he wasn't approving of it. He wasn't saying that's the Nazi policy to tell the biggest lie. In fact, he clearly said that the best propaganda is the truth, didn't he?
That's right.
That's right. So the Hall of Facts, everyone has to do their homework. You can do it, you know, 10 hours on the internet. You can inform yourself of the facts, and the facts show that the official scenario of the Holocaust is a complete fabrication. It did not happen, and it was not physically possible. Great.
Very good.
Next, so we're point, number three, which is closely related to point two.
The Hitler hoax.
The Hitler hoax, right. Everything that I was taught about Hitler, everything that I learned from movies especially, do you know anything? I ask you, listening to me, you know, people say, oh, that's as bad as the Gestapo. Oh, really? Were the Gestapo bad? Well, how do you know what the Gestapo did? I'll tell you how you know. You know, in the same way that I knew, you saw it in a fucking Hollywood movie made by Jews, those particular Jews. Well, when you really go and look into it, find out who the Gestapo were, you find out who Hitler was, and you have to do a total revision of history. The lies about World War II, why Hitler attacked Russia, about who the Nazis really were, about the motives and actions of Hitler, about Dresden, where they burned alive 1.2 million people in 3 days. That's a Holocaust. And this is, and the bottom line for me, when you get that Hitler hoax cleared and you see the truth, the bottom line for me is to a responsibility comes with that. And my responsibility is, it's to tell the world, it's Bolshies, not Nazis.
Right. Yeah. I mean, this is a devastating, you know, area for many to both find out and come up against, but it's more and more people that are at least opening their eyes to it. They're starting to get an interest for it. And as we know, I mean, our world truly is upside down. Our world is truly, you know, reverse. It's a projection of sorts. And in many cases, you have the accuser, you know, being responsible for the crimes that they pose on their own enemy. I think
this is the gift. This is the game. This is the skill of the archontic trickster. Those particular Jews with intent to harm humanity are actually inspired by the archontic trickster, who is known as Yaldabaoth or Jehovah or Yahweh. And the archontic trickster has a number of tricks up his sleeve, but one of them is he continually accuses people of doing to him what he is actually doing to them. They accuse Hitler of doing to them what they are actually doing to Hitler. You know, remember, folks, we're talking about the truth here, the truth about Hitler, the truth about, okay, how's this? Just one footnote before we move on to the next point, because I find such pleasure in knowing this truth. How about this? What is the truth about the final solution, right? The final solution. The truth about the final solution, my friends, is that in 42, Henrik, there was a Jew in America named Kaufman. And he wrote a book, which you can buy on Amazon.com. It's not banned. It's not considered to be hate speech, is it? And what is it called? Germany Must Perish. There is a book on the internet written by a Jew in 1942 called Germany Must Perish. And it's not banned as hate speech. And what does this book say? Basically, it says that the German people must be exterminated. Isn't that right, Henrik?
That's right.
That's right. And the first actually printed instance of the term final solution was not about Hitler's evil plan to kill all the Jews. It's about the plan of those particular Jews to kill all the Germans. This is a fact. This is not disputable. Okay? So much for that point. Big point.
One thing on that, you had a note about reclaiming the swastika, right? This is part of the aspect of attacking ancient Indo-European culture, attacking our mythology and all these kinds of, like, there's so much that comes along with these 3 points that we've mentioned so far that has been so successful in dismantling our own culture and the own appreciation for who we are as a people.
Sure. So much so. And we'll come around to that in the second part when I bring up the ADL, which isn't what you might think it is anymore. We're running the ADL now. I'm running the ADL now. So anyway, reclaiming the swastika comes along with correcting the lies of history. What is the swastika? The swastika, you could say, is like the guiding symbol of the divine myth of all of humanity, but it has been particularly preserved by the Aryan races, white races. The swastika, when you look at it, is the ultimate symbol of our sovereignty and our divinity. It is the ultimate symbol of the cosmic power that is given to us as the magical children of the goddess. What has happened what a horrible turn of events that this divine symbol of the swastika has been turned into a symbol of hate.
I know.
And so we're not just correcting the facts of history and correcting the historical record, but the time has come to reclaim the swastika. And I'm happy to show you at the end of this talk exactly how to do that.
Interesting. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
So let's move on to the next point. Four. White genocide.
That's right. Now, do you agree that there's white genocide happening or not? You know, this is, again, I must say that I am, if you can't agree to the obvious fact that there's a white genocide event happening on this planet, then you're not on the same page with me. Go your merry way. This is a point of cohesion among the truth holders. All the truth holders who are now prepared to take power have to agree on this. Why? Because the truth is, it's right in front of your face. Go read about what's happening in South Africa. Go read about who Nelson Mandela was. Go look at the clip of Nelson Mandela standing there with a crowd of black people with two pot-bellied Jewish handlers to the right and left of him. They're all raising their fists and they're singing a song that says, we're going to kill all the white people. Go look at these things. Look at what's happening in Scandinavia, the weaponized use of Muslims to destroy Nordic culture. The Kalergi plan, Kudnov-Kalergi plan, it's written down in plain English that the globalists, who are largely directed by international Jews, want to wipe out the white population of Europe and replace it with a coffee-colored, Negroid, Asiatic mongrel. Right?
That's correct. That's what's happening.
People, Henrik, yeah. You're one of the people who really put this on the map. You did. I first heard about the Kalergi, whatever his name is, Kovanov Kalergi, from you. And this is absolutely vital intel. So when I say, people say, you know, I say mongrel. Yeah, I don't want to see Europe populated by a bunch of black Asian mongrels. Okay. Oh, is that hate speech? Well, if you think it is, fine. But go and look at the manifesto that says that they're going to do this. I say that manifesto is hate speech, and my exposing their program is not hate speech. It's just true speech.
Yeah, there's even another layer to this, which is Ernest Houghton, and I think it was Ursula Haverbeck that brought this up to, very similar to the Kalergi plan, although it was specifically designated towards the German people, but it was also proposed to eradicate, this was during World War II, proposed to eradicate the German people by infiltrating them slowly with masses of non-European male immigrants and thereby breed war strains out of them, right? So this is kind of a concurrent thread throughout history that somehow there's a problem with Europeans, specifically Germanic people, and that this is an issue that has to be taken care of in some way.
That's right, and that's because the strain of the warrior honor code of life is held very strongly in the Germanic and Nordic peoples, also in the Celtic peoples, such as myself, in the Irish Celtic peoples. The strain of the heroic warrior class is held strongly by that ethnic group, and that is the greatest threat to the Zads and to their non-Jewish accomplices. Hitler was the greatest challenge. He took them on frontally. He threw those particular Jews who were harming Germany out of the country. Well, actually, politely escorted a lot of them out of the country, didn't he, Henrik?
That's right. Yeah.
You know, he was very polite to them and very kind to them. And then when the moment came when he couldn't get them out of the country anymore, he put them in work camps, where they were treated better than many of the Germans who were living in their cities, weren't they?
Yeah, bakeries and music concerts halls and ballet theaters, swimming
they
pools.
They had healthcare, they had hospitals, they had food. Another fact, the Jewish population in Europe, according to Red Cross census, was higher at the end of World War II than it was at the beginning. So these are the facts. And so, white genocide is a reality. And if you don't know it, then you're missing something, okay?
it's the establishment that is taking care of the potentiality of a people, a group of people that can organize an army that potentially could topple them, right? It was, as you said, the Second World War was kind of the last nail in that coffin to a certain extent of trying to prevent people from ever rising up again. And by flooding countries with non-white immigrants and other people that will push their own interests within those countries, there is a desire, a hope, an aspiration there that a people internally won't be able to unify again. So they say, I just want to mention this quickly, they say that, you know, oh, don't try to, drive wedges between us, or don't try to, cause disunity within our people by saying that immigrants are, you know, causing a problem. But the fact is, they were using this projection again. They were using immigration as a way to divide and conquer people, not the other way around. We had a natural homogenous state of people in most countries around the world, although the result's been fights, of course, between people and tribes and things like this. But there was as a balance there set up by nature and through, you know, time and geography, through separation, through borders and territory. And that's what the elite has been breaking down slowly ever since the Second World War. And look at the mess that we are in now in terms of disunity within our own countries, John.
Absolutely. And they've created such a mess, another fine mess, that they can't even handle the mess now. You know, it's obvious. You see, they're in cognitive dissonance. You know, Angela Merkel's in cognitive dissonance, right? Terminal. They can't handle the mess they've created. And that's really great. We've come to a great moment here.
Very good. All right. Number five, anthropogenic global warming, the fraud of that.
That's right. Now, we're not going to argue about this because it's a very thorny subject, but I'm just saying, if you think that the scientific evidence proves that there's a climate crisis on this planet due to human beings causing global warming, then you haven't looked at the facts. And that's all. Go look at the facts. Go look at what the 22,000 scientists who signed a petition saying that the anthropogenic global warming theory was a scam, was wrong. I don't even argue with people about this. But if you don't agree on that, go your own way. You're not able to stand on the platform of the truth holders. Okay?
Yeah, it's another tool to decommission our society and push people into a subjugated state, basically. Nonsense.
Yeah, it's a scam of what's his face? You know, I don't want to say his name. The man
Al Gore, right?
It's a financial scam. You know, that's all it is.
Yeah.
Okay. Six. Oh, I love this one.
Yeah, so this is protection of the gender binary against feminism, LGBT. I don't know if they should have a Q in there or not, agenda.
Right.
Tell us more about that.
Well, I was talking to some friends about this interview, and I said, you know, I'm not sure about point six because sexual preferences might be considered as a too personal item. All of these points that we're outlining, and there's eight of them, are really transpersonal. They involve us all. They're bigger than personal issues. And I was doubting its inclusion. And I said, well, you know, not sure about this gender thing. It's very sensitive. You know, like I came right out and said openly, no gays in the Calico War Party, period.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that rustled a few people. Oh, John hates gays, blah, 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 you know.
Right.
And so one of my friends laughed and she said to me, well, look, if we were forming a team, a climbing team, to climb in the Himalayas, we don't want any handicapped people on our team. And so...
You bigot.
Said, yeah, you got that? So she said, John, what you're actually saying is, as those who hold truth take power and use the skills they need for the power of imagination that's going to lead ahead, we don't want sexually handicapped people on this team. And most gays are sexually handicapped, and certainly LGBT people and transgender people are sick. They're sick. And, you know, there it's no compromise for me. So I say again, are you willing to take a non-compromising stance against the attack on the gender binary and stand for heterosexuality and stand for the beauty and power of man-woman love, then you're on my team. Otherwise, go your own way.
Okay? I think many, John, can see, of course, how this group is being used, as many other groups are, but it's being used, it's kind of a fraction within identity politics, and it's being used against mainstream society, against, heterosexuality and these kinds of issues. But when you say that they're sick, are you talking about the biological basis of the fact that we have, through modernity, through our own kind of intervention, basically has caused, there's a number of issues here, chemical, overloads on people, so that the outcome of this, the outcome of, gender confusion and homosexuality, yeah, and think that it's a side effect of an erroneous behavior that we've adopted ourselves. Would you agree with that?
I would say, if I would speak more kindly, okay, let me back up a few notches here, not show my fangs.
Oh, that's okay. That's not what I mean. Okay. That's fine.
I have beautiful fangs. I just got them last night. That's a great story. No, I'll be kind and say a lot of damage has been done to the human species through brainwashing, education, Hollywood movies, through chemicals in food. And one of the effects of this is the damage to people's sexuality. And it's confusion. They're damaged and confused people. Okay. I won't put the label sick on them. But they're damaged and confused people. And damaged and confused people cannot be given responsibility for what is to be undertaken now, period. Plus, one of the great teachers of power and teachers of sanity was Wilhelm Reich, who did not belong to the Frankfurt School. So if anyone tells you that, and if anyone tells you that he was a Jew, like in the same class as Freud and so on, they are lying or they are repeating a lie told to them. And Wilhelm Reich said that the basis of sanity in human society is the self-regulation of the individual. And the basis of self-regulation of the individual is what he called orgastic potency. Go read Reich. Reich is the handbook of the preservation of sexual power and the gender binary. And this is an incredibly powerful plank in the platform we're building here, okay?
Yeah, but I know that he was, we don't have to get bogged down in this, but I think he was, wasn't he accused by the CIA at the time to be a communist infiltrator or something like that? Wasn't that the controversy at the time with Reich?
Probably. He was set up to be, taken down because he was a threat to the government. Actually, Reich was interested in communism, but you have to understand what communism or socialism was to Reich. Reich was an idealist, and in certain ways, he was very naive. He didn't, for instance, see the evil Bolshevist side of communism the way that you and I can see it now. To Reich, you read in his biographies, and I've read four of them, okay, that he was attracted initially to the socialist communist cause because he wanted to help the working class, the proletariat. And his way of helping them was to set up sexual clinics to teach them sexual hygiene, to teach them about what is an orgasm, how to properly, treat each other sexually. And while he was doing that, his socialism was an idealistic socialism about educating and improving the life of the masses. But the fact is that Reich was thrown out of the Communist Party, I think, three times. And the communists hated him and they burned his works. So he was not a communist in the sense of a Bolshevik Jewish communist agent. Not at all. You have to learn, you have to have discernment here, discernment to see the truth about these issues. So can we go on to seven?
Yeah, next on the list you have detecting and opposing cultural Marxism, feminism, liberalism, and I guess the whole generality of what we call SJWs today.
Right, SJWs, right. The recognition that communism is the primary social evil on this planet is a uniting factor. I honestly don't see how any of us can unite our power and our knowledge and the things that we are doing as individuals in a coherent way unless we all agree that communism is the primary evil on this planet. And communism is a Jewish invention. It was invented by particular Jews, Moses Hess, Karl Marx, and Herzl. And it is a program of the Zads. It is actually their way of taking down the entire human race and elevating themselves to the position of overlords in a communist one world order system. So this is a tremendously important unifying factor. And to understand what cultural Marxism is, if you don't know by now, go spend 6 hours on the internet. Study the Frankfurt School. Learn the tactics of cultural Marxism.
Go to university and fight people who are in their safe spaces.
How they've taken over the universities. Yeah. Learn about Saul Alinsky tactics. You know, the news has come out just in the last 2 days that Hillary Clinton, it's widely known among the people who hold the truth, have found the truth, that Hillary Clinton is a communist. You know, Barack Obama is a communist. It's widely known. The evidence is here. Now it's said that she is actually a red commie agent. Did you hear that?
Nope.
That she was turned by the Chinese.
Okay,
And that really makes a lot of sense to me.
Right, she's been taking money from a lot of different Chinese over the years. I mean, she takes from Saudi Arabia too. She seems like one of these prostitutes that just like, you know, she just does the bidding of whoever pays her, but certainly China would have a big interest in getting in on that game, you know?
All right, that seems to be the case. So it is the responsibility of people who want to make a difference in the world to know what cultural Marxism is and go and study it. It's a good learn and it's exciting to know what it is. Okay, finally, number eight. It's a little redundant because we come back, well, number eight is the summary point. It returns us to where we began. It returns us to the JQ. You see?
Right.
You know, communism is a Jewish plot. And that Jewish plot actually goes back to this Zadokim sect of the righteous ones. It's a plot, and the scenario of that plot is the myth of the God complex of the Jews. The Jews have a God complex. I remember hearing David Duke say it. A number of people have come out and said it in the last few years. Hey, wait a minute. You know, have you heard that more than 50% of the rabbis who preside in synagogues are atheists? Have you heard that?
No, I actually haven't. No.
Yeah, that is a fact. And when I first heard that, I thought, wow, this is really a mind-boggler.
I know about Reform Judaism, which is kind of another branch in itself. And they have, of course, those are the ones that kind of have an arm in like the White House and stuff like that. They're usually invited to kind of push SJW issues and cultural Marxism and stuff like that. And they seem definitely more atheists than maybe religious. So I don't know if it's that branch or if you're just talking even among Orthodox rabbis.
Absolutely. You know, the Reform movement is kind of like a second wing. It's like a soft movement. It makes it look appealing, but in actuality, when you go to the core, what you find is that the Jews are living a myth of their own deification. And the deification began with the idea that they were chosen by God. But since the time of the Sabbatean movement in the 17th century, that idea that the Jews are chosen by God has morphed into the idea that the Jews are the God race. They are God and they worship themselves. And this is the deep, dirty secret of the evil core of Judaism. So communism looks like a political thing. It has nothing to do with religion, but its aim is the same aim that the Jews originally had as a religious aim. That is to say, to be the chosen people standing above everyone else. Well, communism is a system in which the mass of people are reduced to poverty, misery, and enslavement. And standing over them are the commissars, right? And the commissars control all the money. Central banking is one of the platforms of the Communist Manifesto.
Right.
So the Rothschilds are communists. And this is it's a mind-boggling thing, you know, but communism and capitalism, that kind of capitalism, evil capitalism, work together. And there is a responsibility to know these things and to be united among those who know these things. I feel we can take a stand together. So
these are tools that they use to win, to get us to surrender. They push ideology if they need to. They push the political issues if they have to. They push the cultural issue. They push ideological, philosophical. These are just different kinds of tools to manipulate, to convince people, to introduce things that sounds good. And I think one of the greatest kind of tricks that they had up their sleeve was to push this issue of uniting the working classes, you know, because it's such an appeal to the masses. I mean, even the word Bolshevik means like the majority man, basically, the mass man.
That's right.
You know,
it means the majority. Yep. Right. That's right. So, yeah, that's what, workers of the world unite. Well, it didn't work. And so what was the actual result of this call? Dictatorship of the proletariat. Okay. Workers of the world unite. Sounds great. What was the result of that? Oh, 70 million workers murdered in Russia.
Yep.
How many did Mao murder? Because Mao, although he was a Chinese communist, directly inspired by Marx and had Jewish handlers. So the result is that they can't actually get the workers to go along with their plan, so they murder them. So genocide is absolutely required for them. And you use the word they're tools of achieving this goal. Their tools are deceit and lies. That's their tools. Their tactics are deceit and lies. And the game is changing because there are people in the world today who are seeing through this and they are ready to take action. And this is the moment at which we live. And it's pretty spectacular.
It certainly is. Yeah. We mentioned, of course, I mentioned the winter, the Winter Palace, but it goes to this aspect too a little bit. There is a kind of a metaphysical aspect. They use theology, astrology. There's a whole subset of kind of occult ideas within this as well. I don't know if we should go into that now, but it has to do with this aspect of religion kind of weaved into this, right?
Yeah, but it's not religion as such, and I'd like to come around to that point in this, at the end of the second part, but that now that you bring it up, Henrik, you kind of cue me. I think I would say this: cult. Did someone say cult? Okay. Am I a cult leader? Absolutely. Absolutely, I'm a cult leader. If I was the, if I ran a bingo parlor, I would be a cult leader because bingo is a cult. Professional golf is a cult, anything that involves specialized intelligence held by people, Gnostics. Gnosticism is a cult, but it's not a brainwashing cult of deceit and control. So am I a cult leader? Yeah. What is my cult? It's a cult of education. I have an educational cult. You ever hear about that? You see? So let's not be afraid of this word. And also regarding the fact that they had astrological advice of the exact minute to enter the Winter Palace, okay? Well, two can play at that game. Listen to my talks. Go and listen to the Gaian Navigation Experiment. I give out precise astronomical timing all the time. Two can play at that game. We can use that timing frame of astrology, astronomy, that occult esoteric system to do whatever we want, as long as the myth that is guiding us is the right myth. So the question is, what is the right myth that can guide and unify the truth holders? And I'd like to come around to that as our conversation unfolds. So I think we're doing pretty good here. It's about an hour into it.
Yeah. I mean, do you want to say anything more about, you know, because your main premise here is basically if there can be, I guess, some kind of agreement on certain issues that pull people that share these commonalities together in the same direction. Maybe not as a, well, obviously as a way to try to stop, you know, bickering and infighting and all these kinds of issues. Obviously, that's unfortunately a huge problem, and it kind of comes with the territory. Then you have disruptor factors and everything else that actually seek. I mean, just quickly on this, just look at how the world, specifically within America, has reacted, for example, to the alt-right, right? It was brought up even by Hillary Clinton. They have been, Jose Ramos did an, you know, Hate Rising documentary on Univision here just a few days ago released, and they're all tying this into, you know, KKK, swastikas, white supremacy, the alt-right, and they've really become obsessed with this issue, the fact that white people are starting to pull together and they're sick of being displaced and, you know, genocided in their own countries. And now they're seeing now you're starting to see the reaction to this. So an aspect of, you know, more people coming together and pulling in the same direction would be just tremendously beneficial at this point, right?
Well, yeah. And, you know, as for the slander and the lies and the ridiculous, stupid things that some people are saying about you, and I just heard this afternoon, they're starting to say about me, I won't even dignify it by mentioning it. I won't. Such people are beneath contempt, and they have no use to me. Now, these points of this platform that you and I are proposing are bigger than that, man. Come on, get with it. Look at what's at stake. You know, this is a transpersonal challenge. This is a transpersonal project that we're outlining here. So to move ahead with our focus, okay, shall we do that?
Sure, yep.
Put this question, and again, these notes are going to be posted on Metahistory, and Henrik will link to it from Red Ice, and you can all go and read our notes that I base this talk on. But this question, these are the two questions that John Lamlash lives with every day with his two cats as advisors and the huge cult of people that I live in. People around me, right? Right. I expect the new roles to be delivered tomorrow. So, you know, I'm excited about that. Can there be an agreement on a platform for defense and opposition to the Jewish communist menace, you know, that unites everyone who sees the enemy? We agree on who the enemy is. And could that group be united by one standard? Let's say there's one standard, there's one flag that flies over these 8 points that we've outlined. And I suggested some years ago in the GNE what the name on that flag should be. The Greek word arete, A-R-E-T-E, which means excellence. Now, excellence is a standard that does not have any skin color. It's very close to the standard of Aryan. In fact, the word Aryan, which is a Sanskrit word, and the Greek word arete, are almost identical. Well, why is that? Well, excuse me for saying the truth, but it is the white races on this planet, the Aryan, Nordic, Caucasian races, who show the highest standard of excellence in all areas of life and have manifested excellence in the arts, in science, education, literature, everywhere you look. That doesn't mean that white people are angels and white people are faultless. As a matter of fact, there's a fair number of white people that I wouldn't risk my life for.
Oh, yeah.
So it's not a white skin thing. The standard is not a white skin thing. The standard is the Aryan Arete standard. The people who have proven excellence. Look at the German people. I cry out of my love and admiration for the German people and the excellence that they have produced in engineering, in literature, in science, in music, in the arts, in philosophy. It's staggering.
Yeah.
You see? Yeah. So, yes, we do look to the Aryan Nordic races as a particular case who demonstrate the standard of excellence. But it's the standard of excellence to fight for, above all. So I propose this word arete to be brought into our discourse and to be used as a unifying meme, if you will. That's the first question I live with. And I have a plan I shall release at the end of this talk as to how to bring the standard of excellence into action. So set that aside for a moment and now go to the real deep throbbing question that pounds in my heart every day. And that is the question, does the unity and coherence needed to take back the world and make it a free and happy place require a spiritual element that everyone recognizes in common? Does it require what Joseph Campbell would call a focus of the religious imagination? I give you this question. I put out this question tonight on Red Ice. And I don't claim to have the ultimate answer to this question because this is a question that goes toward ultimate truth. This is not just about the conditional truth. Ultimate truth is what? Well, it's about who created the human race? How did the planet come to be? What are we doing here? Where did the archons come from? Who is the mother goddess? Who is the true father goddess? Not the Abrahamic father goddess. Who is the true father god? Excuse me. These are questions of ultimate truth. And to me, I live with this question. Is there a focus of the religious imagination? And if so, what is it?
John, let's go deeper into this now and you know, contemplate a bit on the both on the religious aspect, but also part of your work that you've done on what you called Gnostic intel. You know, there's a basis in that material that you've been talking about for years. And, you know, you have an issue, of course, of what you call Sophia's correction. We've also spoken about that in past shows. But how do you see that being kind of weaved into what we just talked about? And maybe that then, I guess, is your proposal acting as a kind of a focus of religious imagination.
Right. Focus of religious imagination. Now, there are two words that come up, religious and spiritual. And they come up among those people who are holding the truth, who are certain of these 8 points we've outlined, and others as well, but certainly of these 8. There's a certainty about it. And I think you would agree, Henrik, because you're right on the front line with this, and you talk to these people, and you invite these people. There's been some talk about, well, where are we going to get our spirituality from in the next world that's being created right now, you know?
Yeah, and the role of it, right? The importance of it.
Yeah, what is even the role of spirituality? In other words, I guess the question would be, you know, is there a spiritual dimension to the truth holders and to the in the war to reclaim the world for freedom and happiness? Can it be done just by knowing these facts and then each of us taking our role as a warrior? Or does there have to be, or could there be, a unifying spiritual dimension that, again, would bring everyone together and cause and bring coherence and power and synergy. Now, this is a question I live with because, in a way, the work that I develop has leads to that. So I make two proposals straight out to you, and they lead, these proposals will lead the remainder of the talk. The first proposal is that what I've heard so far about the resurgence of the old gods, Odinism. Oh, let's go to Odinism. Let's go back to the Nordic divinities. Let's go back to the pre-Christian pagan divinities. Asatru. Let's reclaim the indigenous religious picture, the indigenous religious values. So there are various, wouldn't you agree, Henrik, there are various sincere people who have the truth on board, who are reaching in that direction, right?
Oh, yeah, certainly. I mean, I think they realize the importance of the fact that if you don't have a mythology, if you don't have, if you can't envision something, if you can't imagine it, if you can't dream it, we are actually not going to be able to create it. I think just a quick note on that. I think our history, our way of life, everything has basically partially been dismantled because we have forgotten our own stories, and we've handed over the storytelling to other people that have hostile intentions against us. So our aspect of reclaiming those aspects is probably more important than the physical, you know, kind of action itself at the end of it, in a long-term sense anyway. What do you think?
In the long-term sense, I would make two assertions. And this is just my educated opinion. I've spent my whole life studying these things, okay, and teaching them. Nothing I've seen so far, the Odinism, the return to the Nordic gods, the Asatru, it ain't going to fly. And I'm going to tell you why. And I'm not going to mince my words, but it ain't going to fly. And secondly, I would be so happy if more and more of you would register something that I've said before. The Gnostic sacred myth of the goddess Sophia is the most single, most repressed and hidden information, if you want to call it that, that has ever existed on this planet. Henrik, you just said that we have lost something. We have lost the myth to guide us. I call it the myth to guide the species, okay? Can you accept that syntax, just provisional? Is there a myth to guide the species? Is there a story to guide the species? You bet there is. You bet there is. And why don't you know that story if you don't know it by now? Not because we forgot, but because monumental efforts were made over centuries to keep this story from us. And this is the only story of its kind. If you want to go and read into Hindu mythology or Chinese mythology, you want to read the mythology of the American Indians, the mythology of the Polynesians, you can go and read hundreds of books. No one has tried to destroy Hindu mythology so that you didn't know about it. No one has tried to destroy the Japanese mythology of the sun goddess so that you, who hid in the cave, and then someone showed her a mirror and she came out of the cave. No one has ever tried to keep that from you. But if you don't know about the fallen goddess scenario of Gnosticism, you need to realize that it's because enormous efforts were made to keep you from knowing this. The reclaiming of this myth is the greatest imaginative achievement of the human species at this moment in history. The reclaiming of this myth. This myth is the myth to guide the species. It has in it everything. There is only one myth on the planet that contains a full and comprehensive story of the planet. And this is it. And you don't have to take my word for that, but you can go and investigate.
I don't know if you quickly can comment on this, but can you say a little bit about the people that were kind of procuring this story, those who, you know, wrote the Nag Hammadi, the library and things like this? This is obviously in current day Egypt.
Who were these
people?
Sure. These people were primarily Aryans from Persia. Something that I want to point out, by the way, in the global picture concerning Muslims and Arabs, which is another story, is that the Iranians are not Arabs. And the Iranian people today are not Semites. They are Aryans. And so they belong to this Aryan culture, racial culture complex, which is the standard bearer of excellence. So there's a lot about this on metahistory.org, but if you go to the origins of Gnosticism, you'll find a long article about what is called the Magian Order, M-A-G-I-A-N. It so happens that as far back as 6000 BC, in the area of the Caspian Sea and the Caucasus Mountains, which is now northern Iran, near Lake Urmia, a movement was founded. And this was a movement of shamans, men and women who practiced shamanism using entheogenic plants. And this particular group, which came to be known as the Magian Order, had a focus. They were the first people who focused in their minds the identity and intelligence of the earth with the aim of communicating with the earth as a living being, with the planet. And so in their process of investigating how they could interact with the earth, how they could access the intelligence of the planet, they developed a myth, which is a guiding story. It's the product of their imagination. It's the product of human imagination, but it's filled with the divine presence. And they developed this myth because they experienced the divine presence directly, just as I did last night with three people here on a mountainside in Spain. And I'm not saying that anyone can do this, but I'm saying that it is there for those who prepare themselves to do it and who are qualified to do it. So they were a very special order. They developed over many centuries, and the Gnostics could be defined. The Gnostics who appeared in Syria and the Middle East and the Levant can be defined as the real original intelligence community. They are the intelligence community of the planet. They are the planetary intelligence community. And their goal and mission was to preserve the sacred guiding narrative, which is the story of this planet. And the central figure in this story is a goddess figure that they called Sophia, which means wisdom. Now, all around the Mediterranean basin and in other parts of Europe and in other parts of the world, this earth goddess Sophia was also recognized under hundreds of names. But they had a unique access to this earth goddess presence, which came through the method they used. That method can be used today. I teach that method. I use that method. It's no mystery. It's no secret. It's an open secret. I've explained it at length. So even though I might be talking about something that looks like a cult here, this is a cult of freedom. This is a cult of total openness and transparency. And so we are the inheritors. I am the inheritor, and those who receive the Sufyanic myth are the inheritors of the Magian Order and the Gnostic visionaries who created this myth and offered it for the guidance and education of our species. Now, I am wondering, naturally, you can see what's coming next, you know, gee whiz. Well, why couldn't this myth, which is unique among all the creation myths of the earth, centered on a divine goddess figure whom you can meet, why couldn't that be the focus of the religious imagination that some people seem to be looking for? Why not?
Would you say that it's correct if I say that kind of this is also an early form of a kind of a science and aspiration of trying to understand and also show appreciation for nature? Because I see kind of echoes within, for example, the later Germanic tradition of, you know, an appreciation for nature, the fact that they made the outdoors their temples, right? The sacred groves.
That's right.
And these kinds of aspects, that there's a kind of an Indo-European tradition here, which is very much an environmental one. Is that correct?
Well, yeah, absolutely. Those original shamans and their many generations after them and their children today, because the participants of planetary tantra are the children and inheritors of this precious treasure, all do the same thing. In nature, out in the trees, in the mountains, by the streams, by the ocean, that is where the religion, if you want to call it, is practiced. And what is this religion? Well, it's called Gnosis. And what is Gnosis? Well, it's cognitive ecstasy. Now, what that means is that you can know things in many ways. If you want to start today and learn how to make sails for sailboats, you can go and study with a sailmaker, and you can know how to make sails. If you want to learn about the works of Shakespeare or the great German poet Hölderlin, you can go to the professors and the universities and the libraries and learn. But if you want to learn about ultimate truth of the human species and the planet, you go to the planet to learn. And you can only learn what she tells you, the planetary animal mother, when you are in a heightened or altered state of consciousness. There are certain things that you can only know when you are in ecstasy, in bliss. This bliss has two requirements. First, it melts your ego temporarily. Doesn't destroy your ego. It just melts it away and removes it. The second requirement is that you allow yourself to be immersed in the currents of her telluric, blissful outpouring. In that state of excitation, of trembling, of feeling the power of the earth come through you tellurically, you have Gnosis. It's an art, it's a method, it's simple, it's open, it's out there for everyone to learn. So the Gnostics are the intelligence community, and they are the specialists who preserve and evolve Sophia's story. And this is what planetary tantra is. This is what planetary tantra offers today.
So should we talk a bit about correction, right? Because within this myth is this aspect of catastrophe. Something has gone very, very wrong here. Tell us more about this.
Well, the myth of the Aeon Sophia, the Aeonic Mother, there are ways to address her, which is great pleasure and privilege to say the Aeon Sophia. It's a reverential term, but it's not some piety or some religious inflation. It's just a beautiful way to express recognition for something divine that's living. The story of the Aeon Sophia is a fantastic myth. It's complex, and there is a certain factor of IQ involved, if you don't mind me saying so. The Gnostics were intellectual shamans. And so it takes a certain amount of attention and smarts to get the myth, but it's a story like any other. So read the story. It's on Metahistory. It's in Notnia's image. Read the story. It's in 9 episodes. The story says a number of really fascinating things. One thing it says is that, well, this planetary system we're in is a divine experiment. And these experiments are actually initiated in the galactic center of galaxies where the aeons of the divinities live. And they project these experiments out into the galactic limbs because it's in the limbs of a galaxy that planetary systems arise. And so right now, as I speak, there are billions and billions of experiments going on in galaxies, in laboratories like the Earth. The Earth is a laboratory for an experiment. And what they say is that, oh, hold on a minute. Well, that's a pretty lovely idea. I mean, I happen to like that idea a lot. That's better than any theological explanation I ever heard, you know? And they say, well, hold on a minute, it gets even better. Not only are we in a divine experiment conceived by two aeons in the pleuromic center, but there are anomalies and oddities in this experiment which make it extremely fascinating. And the Gnostics said two things. I obviously can't elaborate the whole myth here, but the Gnostics highlighted, and I emphasize, two features of the Sophianic myth which ought to capture your total attention. Okay? The first one is that the myth of the Aeon Sophia, who is in material immanence now, her body is the Earth, is open-ended. That means that the myth has no end. The divine beings who created the story of life in which you live did not write the final chapter.
In contrast to like the New Testament or something, right?
Right. In contrast to any other myth you find, most any other myths, especially the Abrahamic myths, have a beginning, a middle, and the end, right?
A violent end, yeah.
Right? The end ain't pretty. So Revelation, Apocalypse, you know, God knows the end of the movie because God wrote the script down to the last frame. Well, with the aeons, it's not like that. They would be bored with an experiment if they knew how it's going to turn out.
Right.
You know, so they leave it open. So when you allow your mind to consider and entertain this myth, you need to know that it's a participatory myth. And that as soon as you really understand it, you'll see that you're implicated in it and you can be an agent in how it turns out. You as an individual can be an agent in how the story of the Earth turns out. This is what the Sophianic myth offers you. Just take a quick moment here to say again, the point that I made at the beginning of our talk, Henrik, is it's easy for people to say, we've got the power, let's use our imagination and create the world we want. Mm-hmm. Great, but you can't do it without the skill. How do you have the skill and the method to use the power of imagination? So it's kind of like self-hype and empty talk to say, we've got the power of the imagination and we're going to do this. I'm talking to you about the precise skills, the method, and the framing story that allows you to use the power of your imagination in the most effective way. There is only one myth that does that, ultimately. Ultimately, there is only one myth. Why is there only one? Well, one is all it takes, my friends. One story to a planet. Please, you know, if we go around telling different stories on this planet, sure, we can tell different lesser myths and learn from them and use them. I love those myths, and the Sophianic myth is not the only myth I teach. I teach about 5 or 6 others, but it is the encompassing framing myth of all others. So
right.
I'm
so,
asking.
So there are kind of similarities. There is a comparative mythology that you can apply here.
There are tributary myths. You know how you have a big river like the Mississippi and you have tributary rivers feeding into it, right?
Right.
There are tributary myths to the Sophianic myth. So there are other myths that can teach a lot about what it is to be human, what our talents and skills are, what is the nature of the supernatural and how to access it. But it is the main myth. It is the main central current myth that runs through our history. And it is, you carry it in yourself You just don't know that it's there until someone shows it to you externally. But if I show you this myth externally, as I've done, I'm only showing you a jewel that is in your own heart, in your own imagination. And it is the key to the skill you need to command your own imagination, to command the power of imagination. And one of the principles of planetary tantra, and this is the second point, because I said there were two points, that comes with the Gnostic teaching. The myth is open-ended. You are involved in how the movie ends. You are involved in writing the final scenes. And secondly, you work with the director. I just published a piece on metahistory.org called Director's Cut, which is a term from filmmaking. You work with the director. Planetary Tantra is a power-sharing arrangement. Today, I think of the many things I could say after a year of, you know, not talking. I've thought about it a lot. I think, you know, I'm not going to live forever. I have to prioritize too, you know. Well, there are many things I can say. What am I going to say first? What am I going to say today? And what I can say today to you with absolute confidence is that if you do not realize that in order to handle and master the power of your imagination, you must work with the power of the earth that gives it to you, then you will never master the power of imagination. You will go off on tangents. You will go into myth-making fabulation, what I call it. Don't go there. Why go there when we have a supreme, beautiful, complex, ever-evolving narrative that we can all join in, and the originality and richness that it brings to your life is unspeakable. I swear to you, the people who are in Planetary Tantra with me tell me this all the time. The enrichment of your life, it doesn't take away your life. It gives you the absolute command of your life, but you can only have that within a guiding narrative. And there's only one guiding narrative that provides it ultimately. And it's here. So I'm wondering, well, do you think it's possible that if attention was brought to this in the right way, that some of the people would find unity and coherence in this story, in this narrative? Is it possible? Her correction is the moment we are living in now. I have used astronomical and astrological factors to time the events of her correction down to the hour. Talk about the Bolsheviks walking into the Winter Palace at 2:12 a.m. I can do as good as that. I can do better than that. I can tell you moments when Sophia's correction is operating in a certain area of human behavior, of the social drama. And when she is bringing her attention to correct that area, and then when you bring your attention to what she is doing in her correction, that's real power. Real power is power sharing. There is no real power without power sharing. That is why the psychopaths and the Zads will ultimately fail, because the power they have is not a sharing or shared power, is it? It's a power to control and dominate. The power to control and dominate is now being overcome by the sharing of power. I share the power that I have with the power of the earth. That is Planetary Tantra. And the way to do it is clear as a bell. The methods there, the techniques are all there. It is not a new religion. It's beyond all religion. And it is not even a form of spirituality, because I'm going, dumping the word spiritual and spirituality, because it's an excuse for too much nonsense and tired of it. So I would propose to you in our talk here, as a closing note, the word transcendent. This is truly the transcendent path of humanity. And it is the unifying factor in taking back the world. I am absolutely convinced of it.
So the if we continue to put this in, I guess, in movie terms, the the antagonist in this drama is the archontic infection, the interface between a kind of a supernatural element to down to the fact that we are talking about an establishment, a tribal elite on our planet that is causing all this mayhem, right?
They are the instrument of it. There is a supernatural factor in the evil on this planet. In fact, the supernatural is what you meet when you come into planetary tantra. You have a working relationship with the supernatural. And I have people around me, you know, close, who will attest to this, you know, with their dying breath, how true this is. It's evidential, it's provable. And part of the supernatural factor that works against us is called the archontic intrusion. Okay? Let me give you an example of how it works. Suppose that we are a group of children in a science class. So we go in and there's the professor and the teacher, and we're in the science classroom, and there's the laboratory and the tables, you know, how it was in science class. And there's some scientific gear, there's some beakers and some Bunsen burners and things, and whatever we're going to do. We're going to do a little scientific experiment together to learn science, okay? Well, class goes on, and the teacher instructs us in one thing or another, and some of us could make mistakes in the course of doing the laboratory experiment. Suppose it was an experiment in electromagnetism. And so I was given a wire, and I'm told to wind this wire coil and put it inside this other thing. Okay, I could make a mistake. I could maybe not wind the wire coil correctly, or in somehow setting up the device, I could make an error. But another student corrects my error for me, or the teacher comes along and says no. So what is it? Well, it's a trial and error process, right? And everyone's happy, right? So we come out of the laboratory, we come out of the class, and we learn this through trial and error, and now we know. Okay, here's the analogy. Now suppose that there is someone in the class who is intentionally interfering with the class, who is deceiving those who are taking the class. Well, obviously, we have another factor in our learning process. We have not only to learn by trial and error, which is the great strength of the human species, proof finding, evidence, trial and error. We were designed to operate with those faculties to a genius level. And look at the excellence of our race. Look at what that talent has produced. But it hasn't even begun to produce what it could. Why not? Because there is a factor of intentional deceit working against it. It works in our minds through the archontic telepathic intrusion into our minds. It works through the supernatural angle of hal, or simulation, the archons projecting phantoms into our imagination, or frightening us and causing us to produce our own phantoms. The archontic attack from the supernatural level comes in a variety of ways. I have totally exposed what that is. The second way that the interference of deception happens is through the proxies of the archons, who are those particular Jews and their non-Jewish accomplices. So why is economy bad in the world? Why is it that I can remember paying in Santa Fe, 23 cents a gallon for gas, and now it's, what, $4 or whatever? Why is the economy always getting worse? It's not because you and I are stupid. It's not because we couldn't create a working economy. It's because there is deceit. We're totally under the assault of deceit. So this factor of deceit is what you confront, and the Sophianic narrative teaches you to see that deceit and stand against it. Correcting that deceit is what Sophia is now doing as of March 2014. She herself is correcting it. And she relies on human witnesses who are trained to access her, to accompany her, and to assist her in this correction. The theme of Safiya's correction, no question about it. Nothing comes close to it. It's the most magnificent prospect that human imagination ever created. And it's real, and you can live it every day.
One of the interesting aspects that I've seen with people within the alt-right is kind of and I don't know how conscious this, but an appreciation for, you know, some aspects of kind of what words do I put on this? Weirdness, esoteric ideas. We saw earlier this year the aspect of Pepe, right, and meme magic, memes and all this. You wrote actually a recent article that we published. It was very interesting, and it went into a little bit of some of the different traditions that already had been brought out that focused kind of on the Egyptian connection, but, you know, what memetics actually is, kind of what it does. Tell us a bit about this, and you think if this is an interface of tools that are beginning to come out to kind of help to put a crack in the opposition that we're facing.
Well, there's an eruption happening in the subconscious of the human species due to Safiya's correction. The power of her third attention, this is a teaching of Gayan shamanism, the first, second, and the third attention. The power of her third attention is piercing the envelope, an envelope or a border in the subconscious of the human animal. And that border in the subconscious, there's a border or a membrane between the subconscious and the conscious, okay? And there's an eruption happening across that border. And the way that people are experiencing that eruption is this: these memes, these things are coming up. These things like Pepe is a great example. And they seem to be charged with some kind of mimetic or magical power. And they're popping up like toads, which is part of the illusion. They're popping up out of the subconscious. But, and behind that, within the depths of the subconscious, which I call the endopsyche, the Aeon Safiya is preparing an eruption like nothing you've never seen. But this is not an eruption of memes. It's an eruption of nemes. And this is in the notes, the printed notes. A neme is spelled differently. A neme is spelled M-N-E-M-E. A neme. It's pronounced neme. It could be N-E-M-E. A neme. I'll tell you the difference between a meme and a neme, okay? This is a meme. What is it? Racist is a code word for anti-white, okay? That's a meme. In other words, that's something that's talked about. It's in the open discourse on the alternative internet, and people are talking about it, okay? But that's not a neme. A neme is a mythological motif that has a very powerful charge in it because it's rooted in the mythological imaginative power of the human animal. So I'll give you an example of a neme. Woden hung on the world tree. That's a neme. That, if you feel the power of that phrase, then you are feeling something erupting out of the subconscious of the human animal. So as part of her correction, Safiya is returning to us, is flooding back into the conscious mind the nemes or mythological motifs that we can use to empower ourselves. And so there's a great eruption. I'll give you another example. Here's a meme that I want to circulate, okay? This is the first meme officially introduced by John Lash. Are you ready for this one?
I'm ready.
Give me a drum roll. Hate is the catalyst for correction. That's a meme. In other words, you can talk about that. It doesn't have a mythological charge. It has a social and sociological impact. Hate is the catalyst to correction. Why are they trying to ban hate? Because the hate is the catalyst that is actually going to produce a better world.
Yeah, I've never seen them so afraid of a human emotion, a function.
They are terrified of this emotion of hate, but it is simply the catalyst to change for the better and the catalyst for correction. You know, so that's a meme. Here's another neem. Remember, a neem has mythological depth and profundity. A meme has social impact. See the difference? Here's another neem. Ishtar descending. See that? When you hear this neem, Ishtar descending, it immediately vibrates into your imagination. It's like as if your imagination was a membrane, and I touch that membrane and I say, Ishtar descends, Woden hung on the world tree. These are powerful mythological images returning now, flooding back into the human mind and becoming conscious as tools for us to use. So Sophia's correction is it. Sophia's correction is what's happening. And to follow Sophia's correction and be a witness of it is to be in the absolute avant-garde on this planet.
Interesting. So how do you see that this is kind of aiding us in the process of, I mean, I've seen more people branch out into this so-called dangerous thinking than I ever have seen before. There's more people that dare to ask these questions. More people seem to be ready for it. I'm not saying that yet, at least there's some kind of mass movement, but as a mundane expression of this, perhaps we've seen the alt-right explode. A lot of people are coming to these ideas. They dare to go against the grain. As you said, the very aspect that they clamp down on you know, issues such as hate or forbidden areas. You can't talk about this. So this is offensive, political. They're trying to inhibit our ability to not only think, but to even express those thoughts in words, right? What is happening here, do you think? Is there kind of almost like a 100th monkey kind of syndrome to a certain extent, that there's enough people thinking and working and pushing in these areas that it's kind of almost automatically opening up in certain people's minds, if you will? What do you think this is about?
The power of the planetary animal mother is opening it up. It's her power and it's sovereignty. And I am absolutely convinced after a year of silence that the sovereignty that you and I seek for ourselves as individuals to work as we like, not be harassed by the Jew-run system, not be told how she should live by righteous people who put us beyond judgment. That sovereignty for you and I, on the granular level of us, carried up to the community, sovereign communities, sovereign homes, to the nation, sovereign nations. All that sovereignty that we hunger for, which is symbolized in the swastika. And there's a new swastika to show that, comes to her sovereignty or not at all. I swear to you, on the eyes of Jan Kerouac, this is the truth. It comes to her sovereignty. It comes to the recognition. So what I ask of people, and I've never asked it openly, I guess that's what this talk is about. I ask you to consider my view that your recognition of the divine Aeonic Mother, call her Lusithia. If you don't like the name Sophia, it's a Greek intellectual Hellenistic term. Okay, your recognition of the divine animal mother, Lusithia, brings you sovereignty and brings us in unity to sovereignty. And without it, it's just going to be disorder and division, even if the world gets better. And I'm sure the world's going to get better by the downfall of the system. It can only get better by the rotting, falling away of the rotten structures. But if you, like I, share the desire to build together as families and clans a better world, then consider recognition. It's all about recognition of the earth, and that it is alive, it is intelligent, and you can communicate with it when you know her story. But if you don't have the framing myth, you're going to go off on one thing or another. You're going to, you know, there's a rule in planetary tantra, and what we call Gaian alchemy. It's a rule from an alchemical text called the Theatrum Rosarium of the 17th century. And it goes like this. Let all your operations be guided by nature. And in those operations, be guided by the true and not the fantastic imagination. So I ask you, what's the difference between the true imagination and the fantastic imagination? It's a question that I have lived with for a very long time. Henrik, you say that people are going off in all these directions. There are all these wild theories, you know, and people get involved in esoteric. So religion isn't going to get us there. The New Age is a con. It's a fraud. It's dead. Oh, well, we're going to invent these new systems of occultism. We're going to invent chaos magic. We're going to invent our own magic. Oh, are you really? Really? Well, I would like to know how you're going to do that if you don't have the skill to do it. It's like saying you're going to go out and build, a sailboat, and you don't have the skill to build a sailboat. So I say to you that there's only one correct way to use your imagination, and that is to use it within the frame of her story and sharing her power, and everything else is wrong. Every other way of using it is wrong.
And it could be, I guess, as a preface here too, or not a preface, it's just a disclaimer of sorts in as we're right in the middle of this here now, but you've spoken about this for many years. You've written about it in Not in His Image, your book. We've done shows on it and talked about it. Many of these ideas that you're proposing, and there is a need, of course, for people that are new to this for the first time to obviously dive deeper into that, to have a better understanding of that, what it entails, and even the backstory, as we've kind of briefly have talked about, is absolutely fascinating, with this archontic infection and these kinds of issues that we haven't really had the time to go in depth into. But do you think that there is an immediate attraction to? I've always seen mythology as something which is kind of, you know, part of the makeup of us as human beings. And we are attracted to certain stories for certain reasons. They just kind of work with us immediately. Is it the same, or is it even, I guess, more powerful with this story? And the reason I'm asking that is because it's always difficult to, you know, introduce something new, right? And make that, palatable, if you will, for people to dive into. But in this case, I guess it's something which is more already part of our mythological makeup, despite the fact that it's been covered up. There should be, maybe to a certain extent, some kind of attraction to that story, because it's our story. Would that, sure, be correct?
Yeah, I can. You bet. You know, I've pondered long and hard, and I've been really troubled about a couple of things. First of all, you know, I'm totally aware that I can come across as a completely arrogant and overbearing fool. I know that. I'm totally certain that some people hear my words and they think, where is this guy coming from, you know? This is the most totalitarian bullshit that I ever heard, you know? He's just saying, well, it's, you know, my way or the highway, you know? You take this way, or everything else is delusion and confusion, you know? I'm aware of that. I've looked at all these things. And I can tell you that it is not my way or the highway. It's her way. I'm just someone who knows her way. That's all. And what is the attraction to her way? You raise a great question. I'm so glad you brought that up, because the answer is really simple. It's in one word. Beauty. Beauty. What brings people to the Aeon Sophia, what brings them back to the love of the earth and of her story, is beauty. That's all. And if the sense of beauty has been wiped out in people because they're too damaged You know, like I would say, Muslims, sense of beauty, right? You're not allowed to dance in the Muslim religion. Is that correct?
I don't know. They have all kinds of weird, like, imposements of what you can and can't do and behavioral.
Right.
You know, that
dance.
Could be very well. I think it was something with the hips, wasn't it? Wasn't it that's why Spanish dance even turned out to be a lot with, like, the hands as opposed to the hips or something? I don't know. Anyway.
It's possible.
Yeah.
It's possible. There are all the taboos, many of the taboos of religion are really in place, not only for mind control. I just picked Muslims because they're a cheap shot. Okay?
right.
Not only to mind control and deceive you and screw you up and make you feel guilty, but those taboos are in place so that you don't reach the beauty and the beauty doesn't reach you. And all I can say is I cannot convince anyone, I cannot persuade anyone of the power and scope of this myth and the wonders of planetary tantra. I can't. I'm not a preacher, I'm a teacher. But I assure you that if your sense of beauty is still intact, that's what leads you there. That's what brings you into planetary tantra and keeps you there. And everyone I know in it will confirm that.
So if listeners want to know more and basically at this point know maybe very little or close to nothing of what you're talking about, but they're like, you know, what is this? Where do they go? Where should they begin? Where do they read?
Well, this talk is so special we're doing because it's really my return talk after a year. And you and I only talked almost 2 years ago, remember?
Yep.
The War Party.
Right.
It was announced on December 26, 2014, right? I've prepared a page on Metahistory dedicated to this talk with the notes and links that people can go to directly to get the background and to fill themselves in on what I'm talking about. You know, the way I'm talking here is typical of a tantric teacher. What I do is I never talk down to anybody. I talk from the top. And you can come to the top. I talk from the top. So I'm taking this exactly, precisely from the top of what I know. I'm giving you the absolute cream and distillation of what I know. I don't build up. I don't gradually go through stages. Because the tantric method is fast and vast. But if you are attracted and if you are captured by it, then I will provide the background that you can go in and with your questions and fill it in. Fill yourself in on it. Okay?
Very good. Now, there was a couple of things that we mentioned earlier that we want to go back to. I don't know if this is too early too soon, but you have some concluding notes here that I want to talk more about, and one of them was about the ADL. You got to tell us more about that later.
Right.
But if that's jumping ahead, please back up.
Yeah. If you would like to leave the people who are listening, whether they have some previous knowledge of my work or whether you're hearing me for the first time, and if you are, you have my deepest compassion. Okay, I want to tell you that the spirit of friendship is called Maitreya. And in the spirit of friendship, I speak to you now. Friends share the same concerns, and these are my concerns. I have two great concerns that guide my life and fill every day. The first concern is how people will come into the Sophianic narrative and recognize the Aeonic Mother. Call her Lusithia. It's a new name. If you don't like any of the other names, it's a neutral name. It means the light giver, the divine light, because she is the source of the organic light. The great secret of the Grail teaching is that the earth is a luminous body. And you can see the luminosity of the earth. I've described it. I saw it last night with three other people. We were in it for 8 hours. The organic light. So my first concern is that you know what the organic light is. You know that the earth is a luminous body. Her story is your story. You don't have a life of your own. You're just a character in her dream. But knowing that you are just a character in her dream gives you your life in a transcendent way. That is my concern, that everyone possible know this. My second concern is with war, violence, killing, and the right use of violence and hate. And so it is quite likely, in the spirit of the Maitreya, that I would dedicate the remaining teachings of my life to teachings about the right use of violence and the moral purpose of hate. And in that vein, I would like to introduce the ADL. Okay? So here is a paper I have in front of me, and I'm going to have it on a PDF file linked to this talk. Henrik will put it up. You can go to it. You can click and download this. It's only 6 pages long, and it's a manifesto of the Aryan Defense League, the ADL. The motto of this league is to excel, create, and destroy. And the symbol of this league is the reclaimed swastika. So you will see, as you pull up the link to this, actually it's a WordPress link, as you pull it up, the new design of the swastika that was used by Hitler and the National Socialists is there. It's changed. It's been reformatted. And this is the symbol of the ADL. So the ADL manifesto is a mission statement with principles, and it has 9 main points. It has 9 propositions. And the 9th proposition of the ADL, the Aryan Defense League, or the Arete Defense League, as you will, is this. 9. The paramilitary wing of the Aryan Defense League is the Calico War Party. So, my second concern is about fighting back and taking down the predators. And when the moment of push comes to shove and the moment comes for violence, how to direct that violence toward the right targets, how to use it with beauty, the beauty that kills, that's my motto. How to use it with beauty, how to use it with nobility, with courage, without guilt, and how to be a warrior in the cause of the earth and the cause of the human species. So as a friend, I share with you, those are my concerns. And I am so happy and proud today to be here on Red Ice. I mean, Henrik and I, we're solid, man. You know, well, we go back 5 or 6 years.
I think it's more than that, isn't it?
Yeah. We're really solid now, and I love the way we aligned over white genocide, and we came together. The way that you steered Red Ice around, you have my total admiration. You really steered it in a direction and gave it a purpose, and I'm right with you on that purpose. I share that purpose. So it's really a moment of pride and happiness for me to be able to announce the ADL.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. And I wanted to also make sure here that we do talk a little bit about Not in His Image, your book on Gnostic vision, sacred ecology, and the future of belief. And let me just read this from the book. It says, basing much of Not in His Image on the Nag Hammadi and other Gnostic writings, John Lamb Lash explains how a little-known messianic sect propelled itself into a dominant world power. Does that sound familiar? Systematically wiping out the great Gnostic spiritual teachers, the Druid priests, and the shamanic healers of Europe and North Africa. They burned libraries and destroyed temples in an attempt to silence the ancient truth-tellers and keep their own secrets. But as Lash reveals, when the truth is the planet Earth, it cannot be hidden or be destroyed. So, you know, definitely pick up a copy of the book, too, if you want to read more. Have you done any revisions or updates on the book, or is it still as it was, John?
It's pretty much exactly as it was. There is a second edition out. I made a couple of revisions, but, you know, it stands up as it was, and that book is the cornerstone, in a way, for everything that I'm talking about. And it not only talks about the problem, but it also talks about the solution. So that book, for those who might be interested in looking into it, is distinguished by a number of points. but it is the first book that ever told the full narrative of the Aeon Sophia from the pagan mysteries, ever told it in complete and coherent form, because I restored the myth. The myth was in a fragmentary form. I went into the Gnostic Coptic materials and I restored the myth to the best of my ability, faithful to the sources. And so there you have the narrative. And in additional to that, the other thing you find in Audin's image is related to what I call Lydia's Vow, which is a screenplay in progress, by the way. And that is the first time ever that the nature and presence of the organic light was revealed publicly. That's Lydia's Vow. You can go read Lydia's Vow. It's on Metahistory under Lydia's Well. And the Gnostics stood in an ecstatic state of ego meltdown, with the rapturous telluric currents of the earth pouring through their bodies, in the presence of a light radiating from the earth. It doesn't radiate through the sky like natural light. It comes out of materiality, out of the materiality of the earth. And they learned and encountered the goddess in her white goddess nakedness. That is the beholding of the organic light. That is the true experience of attaining the Holy Grail. The Holy Grail is the organic light. And Notnez image is the first time that it was ever publicly revealed, because the Gnostics who had that experience did not disclose it publicly. They enriched and renewed themselves at the fountain of the organic light. They learned profound things and many practical things, and they turned around and taught those things to the world. The Gnostics were the educators of the ancient world. They taught literacy. They taught map making. They wrote countless books on astronomy, medicine, music. Where did they get all that knowledge? They got it from their encounter with the white goddess, Lysithea. And I am the first person to openly describe that light, its properties, how it behaves, how it looks, how it feels. But I am not the only one to encounter the light. And there are other people, and you're going to be hearing from them soon, who might be talking to Henrik, or you might hear them somewhere else. You might be talking to Lana, I think, soon, who are going to tell you the same thing. And they will tell you they have been there. They have seen this. They have been in the presence of Lysithea. So as that's all in Notnez image. It's the doorway to the Sophianic mysteries of today, that book.
Very interesting. We'll add links to the book, of course. We have metahistory.org. That's your main website. You also have kalikawarparty.org. We did a show entirely on that. And then, right, of course, make sure to send me the link to ADL as well, so we can link that up. But what else, I guess, final points would you like to bring into the conversation here that we've missed before we start wrapping up for today, John?
Well, I think that the turnaround of the swastika symbol is so important, because how can we have sovereignty, as I said, at the granular level of your personal life, all the way up to the sovereignty of nations, if the symbol of that sovereignty has been turned into a symbol of hate? I mean, this is probably the ultimate treachery. Can you fathom this treachery?
Yeah, I mean, there's no other symbol that has been charged with the negativity.
Yeah. Why have they turned it into a symbol of hate? Because they're terrified of the power of the symbol.
Right.
And so claiming back the swastika with the new design of the ADL, with the white swastika on a black circle, with a gold circle at the center, and an amber background and a red border. Every single detail of this flag of the ADL, if you will, I explain in the manifesto as well what every detail of the redesign of the swastika is. So for me, this is a big thing for me to like put this thing out here, this ADL. And I'm happy about it. And I would like to say that the biggest challenge now, Henrik, I think, is this hate thing. How far are they going to go with this hate speech thing? You know, it's the deal breaker.
Oh, they're never going to stop. That's their weapon of choice.
They're never going to stop until you stop them or I stop them. And there are many ways to stop them, but don't rule out lethal force. I don't rule out lethal force. So my teaching, my instruction in the future is going to be about sacred violence, the correct use of violence, and the moral purpose of hatred. They're trying to take hatred away. I mean, it's natural and normal for a human being to hate.
Well, listen, they've cornered us in a specific manner that has, you know, basically make people impotent, or what do you call it? They're unable to, you know, to act or enforce, basically balancing the imbalance that we have right now, while, of course, their own behavior is very much exhibiting the same factors, right? I mean, just the lies and the murder that they're behind, these elitists. And, you know, again, let's just look at what's happening now with Hillary. All this garbage that she's been behind that's coming out now, that's leaking out. And that truly shows that she can stand on stage. I mean, she's just a face for this. So it's really not her, maybe personally, but what she represents of, like, they standing there on stage and talking about how, you know, hate is the worst thing ever, and
right,
no to violence and all these kinds of things. And then they're, like, behind the worst hate and the worst violence that the world has ever seen. You know, it's amazing.
Well, this is the trick. This is the treachery of the archonic trickster in our minds that is being implemented by the human proxies of the trickster. See, I'm talking here. This is Gnostic intel, pure. And the claiming back, it's a natural instinct to hate that which is against life, that which threatens your life and your freedom. It's like they want to destroy the one natural instinct that we have to take them down with. It's not love at this point. Love's not a problem. Now, I've often said, you know, and I quote Rajneesh on this, it's very good. You should listen to what he said about the teaching about love has ruined our capacity to love. Rajneesh said that.
Is that now, Osho? I don't teach, same as Osho?
Yeah, Osho, right.
Yeah, okay.
I don't teach that, and very simply because why? Well, I don't teach love as the answer, because those of you who are already disposed to love know that, and you don't need to be told. And those who are not disposed to love will not accept the teaching. So there's no need to teach love. It propagates itself by proving itself. It's its own proof. But teaching hate, this is the thing, this is the crucial tactic right now. And it's, I am certain and I am confident that their game is at an end. And it's falling apart, like, by the hour. So our timing in this conversation has been absolutely perfect, you know, for me.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, and it makes them also very, well, there's twofold. It makes them very dangerous because they become, I think, more and more unpredictable as their power, you know, begins to crumble and fall apart. So we don't know how are they going to strike back and things like this. But that also is going to expose them even further. I think they're in a basically unsalvageable spiral, death spiral, where they were going to continue to try to enforce these hate speech laws, or they're going to, you know, literally put, you know, haul people away that has to quote wrong opinions and things like this. And as they're doing these actions, it's just going to prove our points even further. So wherever they, whatever, you know, on the chessboard, so to speak, whatever move they make, it ultimately is one, I think, that's going to benefit us.
I agree. They are in a death spiral. And also, let's not be naive. They are ugly and nasty, and some of them are not going to go down easy.
That's right.
They want an ugly end. If they want an ugly end because they're ugly. So, let's not be naive. Psychopaths don't calculate the consequences of their own action, do they?
No, I feel many times that they're not part of building anything up. Their whole MO has been to destroy us, destroy what we have, destroy civilization, enlightenment, beauty, these things. That's what they're all about. So they don't care if they go down with the ship. This is their programming. This is their function.
They don't know any other way. You know, the use of power for domination will always end up destroying itself. Power shared will create. Power sharing is the creative enterprise. It's the creative adventure, and they don't share power. So their own power, you could say in a sense, their own power is going to take them down. But I plan to give them a good nudge if I can. And as far as being dangerous goes, well, yeah, they are dangerous. They proved that, haven't they? Well, let's see, you know, how to be dangerous in our own way.
Yeah, let's see what happens when we are no longer fighting at 1%, you know, level, when we actually start pulling things together, organizing, and fighting back at 80, 90%. Then we'll see what happens with the game plan at that point, you know.
The symbol of the Calico War Party is the wolf pack. You know, the Calicos are wolves. They live in packs. They live in, I'm in a den right now with some Calicos. We lay around the fire at night in the hills, and we can smell. We smell like animals. You can smell our fur, and we growl, and we look at the stars, and we're dangerous wolves. Dangerous wolves. I will link in the pages relevant to this talk a wonderful little 10-minute clip about what is called trophic cascade, which is a phenomenon that ecologists have discovered concerning wolves in Yellowstone Park, and about how the predatory kill of the wolves allows many other species to live and to prosper. This is a metaphor for the Calico War Party. So if anybody's wondering what's happening with the Calico War Party, I can assure you that it's on, but it is not a virtual event on the internet.
All right, very good. Well, Mr. Lash, thank you. Good talk. Always great to connect with you. I appreciate that you wanted to come back and speak with us again. I've always highly admired your work. You know, many things that we've spoken about in the past has been some of the most engaging shows, I think, that we've done. And it's always a pleasure to have you on the show. So, yeah, don't be a stranger. Let's keep track of what's happening right now. And anytime, we'd love to have you back.
I would love to come back at any time. It's a pleasure and a privilege for me. And I leave you with the same thought that I leave with now. And that is, where is our transcendent factor? Where is the transcendent factor to unite us? So on that note, wish you all the best. And I'll see you down the road.
Well, I think that there are certain points of agreements that should serve as bridges between people that on other points have disagreements. You might not fully be into, let's say, the mythological aspect, the esoteric aspect, but the realization that the urgency of the tax on us is just too important to ignore. That's a vital aspect, and that we need alliances wherever we can find them, people who share the same basic concerns, and see who it is that's doing this to us. After this election, whether Trump will deliver on everything or not, this has been a powerful, extremely powerful, shot across the bow of the already sinking Titanic that the globalists are on. And we can work with that. We can work with that discontent. No one ever said that the outcome of this election is going to save the world. Well, maybe a few did, but I don't share those sentiments. It's just a step in the right direction and a sign of what is to come and what is possible when we, you know, put pressure and start pushing back. Well, thank you for listening today, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be back in just a few days. Much more coming. If you like the show, if you like our TV episodes, our live weekend show, do sign up for a membership with us, redicemembers.com. You can also donate to us. It's paypal.me/redice. Thank you so much for considering helping out and helping us to grow and expand. We will keep you updated on the website whether or not we can squeeze in a shorter Weekend Warrior this coming Sunday, you know, due to preparations of the NPI live stream November 19th. We are tremendously busy and have so much more to do. So we'll keep you posted on updates and more information about that. redicemembers.com/live and redice.tv/live for updates. But as I said, NPI is really the next big live stream that we have coming up. Thank you so much for listening today, ladies and gentlemen. We'll talk to you soon. Strength and victory. Have a good day.